Thank you very much. I'm Nicholas Kristof from the New York Times, and I'm privileged today to engage in conversation with Guy Ryder, the Director General of the International Labor Organization, who joins us from the apparently somewhat empty ILO headquarters in Geneva. Welcome, Mr. Ryder.
Thank you very much, Nick. Thanks.
Please, and I also just want to congratulate the council on engaging with this issue and all of you to join the symposium. Before we started, we were just talking about the degree to which the international relations agenda has expanded over the years. And, you know, when I joined the council, the idea was we would sit around and talk about missiles and maybe trade and things like this. And now there's, I think, a much broader perception of what actually belongs on that agenda. And the recent council report on trafficking is a reflection of that. And this symposium is a reflection of that. Guy, maybe we can start by, can you tell us a little, the ILO has been engaged in fighting forced labor for many years. So tell us a little bit about the scale and challenge of forced labor or trafficking around the world today.
Sure. And again, thank you very much for having me in this conversation and for having the conversation. It's a really necessary one. There is something I was going to say slightly shocking. I was going to say profoundly shocking about the fact that, you know, at this stage, we're still having to have a major discussion about forced labor and human trafficking in the world, given that the world has been working on the elimination of slavery and forced labor for centuries. It is, in fact, there's good reason to say that this is the oldest endeavor in international cooperation and civil society. If you look at the abolition movement, going back to the 18th century, my goodness, and here we are still talking about it. Well, the ILO in its 100-year history has made the elimination of forced labor one of its central endeavors. And it's interesting to see how this endeavor has changed over time. The very first ILO convention around forced labor, it goes back to 1930, and it's almost universally ratified right now. This was about really forced labor in colonial settings, in what we politely call non-metropolitan territories, and how colonial regimes dealt with forced labor. And then there was a second convention adopted in the 50s, which was much more an instrument of the Cold War. It was about how forced labor should not be imposed for political reasons in terms of prison labor, et cetera. And more recently, we've adopted a protocol very recently in 2014. We're looking at the international dimensions of forced labor. This is where trafficking comes in. In my mind, trafficking has an implication of movement, of transfers of victims, either across national borders or within national territories. So you see, it's somewhat unfortunate phrase to use in our current times. I see forced labor as a virus which mutates and takes on different forms and doesn't lose in virulence in the process. So what can I tell you today, Nick, that there are, by our estimations, 25 million victims of forced labor in the world. That's an estimation we made in 2016. If you add on the victims of forced marriage, you'd add another sort of 15 million onto that, takes you up to 40 million. That aggregate is what we call modern slavery. So that's the extent of the problem. What I think the council report, which you've referred to, and I want to congratulate the council upon, does very, very well is to say, well, you look, forced labor is clearly an awful abuse of human rights and of any concept of how we want our labor markets to be organized. But it's also got security implications, the sort of things, as you say, the council likes to talk about, and it has economic implications as well. And I think you have to look at the full complexities of the phenomenon that we're dealing with to work out how we should best respond.
You noted that indeed it was actually Britain, your country, that in the 1780s really changed the world by beginning a global abolitionist movement. And the term that I use, that others tend to use, is modern slavery. The ILO figure for that is about 40 million worldwide. I guess I wonder one of the trade-offs that I face as a writer is I want to get people's attention. I want to shake them up. I want them to understand how evil this is. And so I tend to use that word modern slavery, which galvanizes your response. On the other hand, I do worry that I sometimes turn people off and that the ILO turns people off by seeming to engage in hyperbole. And that, you know, particularly if you think about those 15 million people who are married underage, you know, is that really comparable to what classical slavery was? So how do we, you know, is it fair to talk about modern slavery? How do we think about this?
Yeah. Well, I have to say, sort of in defense, in light of what you've just said, we historically have always limited our discourse and our activity to what we properly call forced labor, which is very much exploitative work conditions. The point is made, and when the UN adopted its 2030 agenda, it brought in the notion of modern slavery. That did import, if you like, the notion of forced marriage. And of course, as the council report mentions as well, you can look at trafficking for human organs and other types of abuse and amalgamate them. Now, I think, I'm not quite sure if it's hyperbole which is our enemy in this fight. I wonder if it's clarity in the vocabulary. You know, we know what we're talking about. The common denominator, at least in the ILO's way of looking at these issues, is coercion. Coercion, people being made to work in absence of freedom, absence of choice. And if you want to really, as you do as a journalist, Nick, shake people up and get their attention, you only have to zoom in and look at what is behind these different varieties of forced labor. And there is an enormous diversity of forced labor. Let's not forget that about half of victims of forced labor are in debt. They're in debt bondage of one type or another. This could be centuries old. You know, you go to the Indian subcontinent. Now, intergenerational indebtedness, that means people are born into these coercive situations. There, I think the notion of slavery is probably apt. And more modern forms of indebtedness where, you know, workers are being promised jobs in a different country, but they have to pay an awful lot of money to get that job. And they go to that other country, their terms and conditions are not what they expected, and they spend the next decade or more trying to work their way out of debt. They never expected to be in that situation. It is deceptive. And then there's another type of forced labor. Just consider that man or that woman, often a woman, let's be honest, working in a global supply chain, sewing garments in some country in Asia, and they're told with no ability to dissent that they're going to have to work an extra 4 or 5 hours at night. Never mind the kids at home. They have to do it because an order's just come in. The doors are locked. Get working. And when you've produced the necessary order, you can go home. Paid or unpaid, that is also forced labor. So when you zoom in, you get a real feel for the complexities, but also the human suffering that's engaged in all of this.
Yeah, and I would endorse that. And you know, you can't visit a brick kiln in India where kids are destined to work all their lives without seeing that as a modern form of slavery. You can't visit a brothel in Cambodia or Pakistan where girls are locked up and in some cases until they die of AIDS without thinking of this as modern slavery. Or, you know, people stuck on fishing boats unpaid for years. And so you know, I'm with you on that. Now there has indeed been growing awareness of forced labor and trafficking over the years. There has been important legislation here in the United States, the Trafficking Victims Protection Act, and the international reports that have emerged from that. Have made some difference. So, does it feel as if you and the ILO and more broadly the world is chipping away at this problem? Or whether larger economic forces and greater mobility are expanding it despite our efforts to tackle it?
Both of those things are true, I think. Firstly, that I do think there is greater political awareness, political commitment to act against forced labor and slavery. To its great credit, the United States, and I think this applies between administrations, it might apply with greater force to some administrations and others, and we have enormous hopes of the Biden administration, but the US has been pretty much in the lead in all of these things. So I do see an upsurge in interest and political commitment. In my own country, in the UK, we adopted a modern slavery act, you know, about 7 or 8 years ago now. And the Prime Minister shocked the UK by saying, there are 13 million slaves in the United Kingdom. And people said, my goodness, how is that possible? And we're seeing across Europe, in any case, you know, a whole series of pieces of legislation designed, and here I think is a key to the question, designed to work out how we get to the roots of the increasingly complex processes of coercion and trafficking to which people are involved. Let's be honest, this situation has become massively more complicated to understand and to address. If we were having this conversation, I guess, 50 years ago, we would have been talking about state-sponsored forced labors, those repressive governments who, as a matter of state policy, subjected their people to forced labor in all sorts of settings, be it in the Cold War setting, be it in Myanmar, which is probably the biggest example of recent years, and where we have to fear that very strong forward movement is going backwards now. But it would have been a state problem. It would have been, what do we do with governments that sanction and encourage forced labor? Difficult things to solve, but not difficult to understand. Let me put it that way. Now, we know today that of the 25 million forced laborers in the world, about 21 million are subject to forced labor imposed by private actors. Who are those private actors? How do you identify them? How do you hold them to account? How do you, where necessary, put them in prison and stop them doing what they're doing? That is a much more complicated proposition. And it involves, I think, a much more sophisticated discussion of the type that the council report very helpfully puts before us about how private actors need to be involved and held accountable, and how governments have to continue to exercise their responsibilities. So, and of course, the traffickers and the forced labor exploiters are becoming more sophisticated. We know all of the broader issues around organized crime in the world, and these things are intimately connected. Without going to the non-state actors who are engaged in other political agenda. So I think that, yes, we're seeing an increase in consciousness and mobilization to solve the problem, but I think we're dealing with a much more sophisticated and difficult enemy that we have to overcome. So who's going to win that battle? But the battle is getting, I would say, bigger. The stakes are getting higher.
I think the point you make about the private sector role is enormously important. Of course, those private sector abuses happen in part because of complicity or obliviousness on the part of governments, which we can influence. I was once at a border crossing on the India-Nepal border. And it was a kind of remote crossing in Bihar. And there were these girls, young girls crossing from being bussed in by traffickers from Nepal, headed for the brothels of Mumbai and Calcutta. And there happened to be a special branch police officer who was there at this crossing. And he was delighted to see me as a foreigner. We were chatting and I asked, so, you know, what are you doing here? And he said, oh, because of pressure from Washington, the special branch had posted him there to look out for terrorists or for pirated DVDs. And I asked, well, what about all these, you know, all these girls who were being smuggled to the brothels? And, you know, it was not a priority. And so he wasn't interfering with that. Well, he was looking out for pirated DVDs. And, you know, it does strike me that we can make those police officers as conscious of human trafficking as they are about pirated DVDs.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, I've got a similar story to tell about Nepal, Nick. I mean, sitting talking to a young man who was actually at a well-organized, they call them migrant workers center. He was being basically processed to go and work in Qatar through official channels. You couldn't say he was being trafficked. You couldn't say that there was an illicit or a covert operation. But I said to him, do you know what you're going to? And he said, well, I've got a vague idea. I have friends who are in Qatar already. And I said, well, what did they tell you about it? And they said, well, what they told me was, even if you're starving to death, don't come here. And he said, but I'm still going. I'm still going, because he didn't really believe it could be so tough. And he saw this as an adventure. And he had absolutely no prospects at home in Kathmandu. So this is quite a dramatic process. And I think it brings out a point that we need to understand. You know, we've got to attack forced labor from all sorts of angles. And one, and this is a great example of it, is recruitment processes. I mean, people have to be, we have to be confident that people who are recruiting workers, often on completely fallacious terms and conditions, we have to get into a serious process of regulating how these people operate. And that does bring us into the broader issue which you've raised of the role and responsibilities of the private sector. I mean, I have yet to meet in my substantial number of years working in this area any employer who would justify or approve forced labor. They don't do that. Nobody would do that. And yet, willingly or unwillingly, and I would say in the vast majority of cases, unwillingly, we know that private actors do get involved in forced labor and that they do profit from it. The profits are big, 150 billion, according to our estimates. So the question is, what can we reasonably expect of private actors in the fight against forced labor? And I think the fact that the UN has worked out the RUGI principles of business and human rights is a really good starting point for differentiating what it is we expect governments, the state to do, and where the responsibilities of business and the private sector come in. And if you can sort of conjugate those two roles, then you're going somewhere. Then you're going somewhere. But I'm not sure we always manage to do it.
Your example from Nepal sort of underscores the importance of the push factors that drive people to listen to the recruiters. And I must say, it strikes me that the Western impulse to address some of these abuses has often been with regulation and to encourage countries to pass national regulations. And, you know, indeed that's important. But I wonder if we haven't done enough to address the push factors. And for example, it seems to me that the laws against child labor have done less to reduce child labor than have various school feeding programs that or programs like Bolsa in Brazil or Oportunidades in Mexico that created incentives for parents to keep kids in school. So I wonder if we should do more to complement the regulatory approach with these incentives and efforts to invest in well-being.
I think it's a key point, Nick. I think one thing we've learned, we're sort of segueing into child labor rather than forced labor, but I think similar considerations really apply. We've learned in the fight against child labor, where we've had big successes, we've brought down child labor by one third since the beginning of this century. What does it take? Well, it takes the right laws and labor inspection and enforcement. That's clear, but it won't be enough on its own. It clearly won't be enough on its own. We learn that the most powerful factors of progress are access to affordable education and quality education. It makes sense to have your kids do something other than working. Social protection systems and income support, availability of decent work opportunities for parents, and also community buy-in, the notion that, this village or this area, the local chiefs will not tolerate this sort of thing. So you do have to address those push factors. And I think that makes our current circumstances a little bit worrying, because given what COVID-19 has done to the world of work over the last year and a half or so, we know there's been a big uptick in poverty, working poverty. So that's people working and still in poverty. We reckon it's gone up by just over 100 million in 2020. That places people in conditions of great vulnerability to forced labor and child labor abuse. And it means, I fear, that numbers are going up right now. We know that child labor, for the first time this century, is going up, not down. And although I haven't got figures to offer you on forced labor, intuitively one suspects that we're on the same upward rather than downward path. And that is, well, immensely worrying.
So let me just follow up on that in terms of COVID. So just to clarify, COVID has clearly increased poverty, increased need. We have seen a measurable increase in child poverty, and we believe that there is an increase in forced labor, but we don't have data to support that. Is that kind of where we stand?
That's exactly right. We'll be bringing out new forced labor estimates next year, I think. But for the moment, if you make an intuitive sort of analogy from forced labor, from what we know about child labor, this is what one would suspect. And I think there's one other big word that we have to introduce into this conversation, which we wouldn't get the right picture if we didn't talk about it. This is about informality and the fact that the majority of working people in the world work in conditions of complete informality, where regulation doesn't apply. You can have the best laws in the world, it doesn't apply. 2 billion people work in conditions of informality. And of course, these are the reservoirs of working poverty and vulnerability. So yeah, this is where we stand.
The COVID pandemic, we hope will ease worldwide. The climate change challenge will not ease and may be exacerbated. And presumably that is driving climate refugees, driving poverty, driving a drought in some areas. Are you concerned that climate change will have similar kinds of impacts on a more sustained basis than the COVID pandemic?
Absolutely. And I know that you're speaking from tropical Oregon at the moment, so this issue is very much on your mind. But there's no doubt about it. And you know, as we deal with all sorts of issues, COVID-19 amongst them, I think we have to understand, and it's increasingly understood in the world of work, that the existential threat to us all, and certainly to a healthy labour market, is climate change. It is going to make human activity, be it agricultural cultivation or other forms of work, impossible. It's going to lead to massive displacement of people. It is already leading to that displacement. And this disruption is simply going to be on a scale and of a nature that I think few of us can really comprehend. And it's happening now, and it's going to require, because, let's look at it logically. If we believe this climate change is a result of human activity, which is a basic scientific proposition, most of that activity is work or work-related. So we have to reboot the way we produce and the way we consume in order to basically work on climate change at source. And I'm afraid that this is going to be difficult. Climate change has a very, very strong social component. We're unequally exposed to the effects of climate change, but the way people make their living is also intimately linked to climate change and in a very unequal way. So the biggest structural changes ahead, and it's great that the US seems to be getting on the bandwagon now, the biggest structural changes ahead is how we adjust the way we work to saving the planet. It's as simple as that. It is a bit of hyperbole, but I think that's what it comes down to.
We discussed the exploitation by the private sector. There are also, of course, the challenge of the private sector in the UK and the US who are manufacturing products or using imported products or raw materials. And so, when I talk to companies about fish, for example, they insist that it's just so difficult to know whether a fish has been harvested using forced labor or not, or whether they buy cotton from a company in Guangdong, but whether that originated earlier from some kind of a labor camp in Xinjiang, they say they just can't verify. So how true is that? I mean, that's obviously in their interest to say that. And are there more things they can do to really verify and nail down their supply chains?
I think this is a really, really key debate of the moment, because I think with the business and human rights principles, which are now, I think, very broadly accepted as being the right template to address these issues through, we have this notion that businesses, private enterprises, should exercise and the buzzword is due diligence, ensuring that their activities do not contribute to or are complicit with human rights abuse. So we have, I think, broad acceptance. It'd be interesting to see what the views in this meeting might be, that companies, yes, accept the responsibility of doing due diligence in their supply chains. But, and this is where I go to your question, Nick, it is difficult at the moment to find a uniform, broadly accepted definition of what due diligence consists of. Does this go to the first tier of suppliers? Does it go to the second tier of suppliers? Does it go all the way down the supply chain? And let's be honest, the further down or up the supply chain you go, the greater the danger is of finding something unacceptable. And I, like you, hear some companies say, this is beyond our capacity. This is not reasonable. These are issues for which the home country government are responsible. It's about national capacities. Talk to them. And we haven't got, I think, consistency or a consensual understanding of what the limits and extent of due diligence really are. And I hear companies, some companies, and I won't mention them by name, say, you know, with Google satelliting, with, you know, the right type of imagery, we know everything that's going on in our supply chains. Others, and phishing is a good example, say, well, that's impossible. So inconsistency. And this is leading to a key debate about whether it is appropriate or sufficient today to say that due diligence must remain a purely voluntary act. That is to say, something which private enterprises accept responsibility for, but exercise in their own understanding of what their reasonable responsibilities can be. That's one way of looking at it. The other is mandated due diligence. That is to say, governments step in and basically require, mandate certain types of behavior by companies. And the council report goes to these issues. Some of the early mandated due diligence legislation is purely about transparency, that companies just have to say what they are doing about forced labor in their annual reports. UK Modern Slavery Act's a great example. Companies over a certain size have to publish what they're doing to eliminate due diligence, and you are eliminate forced labor. And it is perfectly compliant with the law to say, we are doing nothing. It's just the transparency of letting society and the consumer know. Increasingly, we're seeing something more than that. And developments in Europe, European Union legislation in the making, legislation that went through the Bundesrat in Germany last week, are actually saying in a much more you know, clear way, not that you have to report on what you're doing, you have to do this, 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 and this. And in my organization, this is still a debate which is open. There are quite widely divergent views about what the right dispensation should be. But I think this is really, if you like, at the cutting edge of this state-private sector reconciliation or conjugation of effort that can move us forward.
I would I would just argue for mandatory efforts, partly simply on the basis that there is a certain expense involved and we shouldn't punish companies that if we don't make it mandatory, then we place companies to do the right thing at a competitive disadvantage, which is one consideration. I do want to come in a moment to questions, and so please raise your hand if you'd like to ask Guy Ryder a question. One question, before we do. So we, aside from the obligations of private companies, we also have ethical obligations as consumers. I think we're both wearing shirts with some cotton in it. When we buy cotton shirts, how do we as consumers know that that is not a product of forced labor? When I buy tuna, you probably buy tuna. How do we know that that can of tuna in the supermarket, with all these brands, how do we choose a brand that is not going to be taking tuna from a fishing boat that has some Rohingya who's been locked on that boat for the last 6 years? What do we do as consumers?
Yeah, I wish there was a short and good answer to your question, Nick. There isn't. There truly isn't. I mean, 30 years ago now, And this organization, there was a discussion about trying to introduce and promote a social label in garments in particular. I guess it could go on the tins of tuna as well, to say that somebody, the ILO or somebody, can certify that this good is free of child labor, forced labor, and other abuses. And you know, it sort of builds on the historic union label experience of the United States. You'll be familiar with that. It's never happened. Now, there are, of course, private initiatives going in this direction. The question is, you know, verification. You know, how much confidence can one have that, you know, something on a tin or something on a garment which tells you that this product has been produced in acceptable conditions can be relied upon? We haven't got anything like, I think, any international standard to date that could give a consumer that type of confidence. Of course, different companies have, I think, different degrees of credibility due to their own internal processes, their own internal due diligence, some of which I can make a judgment about and think, I think, well, that company is pretty reliable. I think I can trust that one. I'm not so sure about the other one. But I think for the average woman or man down the supermarket or down the clothing store, this is difficult still. This is really, really difficult. And I think we're some way away from providing the type of reliable information. I mean, think of anything sourced in China. How are you going to make this apply to such circumstances, or other countries indeed? I think it's great that consumer pressure and consumer expectations become a lever and a point of traction in this discussion. But I'm not sure the consumer has all the instruments at hand that can make this work as reliably and as well as we would like.
Well, I'd like to broaden the conversation now and share Mr. Ryder with all of you. Let me turn this over to Kayla, who will call on people to ask questions.
We'll take the first question from Mark Lagon.
Thank you very much. And we really, all of us, appreciate your leadership, Mr. Director General. I wanted to ask about a couple of issues that I raised in the dialogue with the study group that informed this report. One is, do we need to think more about small and medium enterprises that have a problem of human trafficking in their sourcing, in their migrant labor? And should, you know, the major multinational companies not just push down the legal responsibility, but really help them? And then secondly, you know, I speak as the former U.S. ambassador to combat human trafficking, isn't the moral priority to help the survivor? And is job training and placement in another job the true way to help someone reclaim their dignity? These are two things that the Global Business Coalition Against Human Trafficking I've been involved in have been taking up.
Shall I respond immediately? I guess that's the way we should proceed. Yeah.
Please do.
Look, I think that the whole question of our expectations of small and medium-sized enterprises is crucial. And now, it's not an issue which has gone ignored, particularly in the business and human rights space. I think you could probably argue, and people do argue, that well-intentioned small and medium-sized enterprises simply do not have the wherewithal to comply with all of the due diligence expectations that one would want large multinationals to deal with. And that's a fair enough point. On the other hand, small and medium-sized enterprises are eminently well-placed to know what they're up to, what they're doing, what their own processes are. And there is no reason, I think, why the expectation in material terms of the practices, the labor practices of a small and medium-sized enterprise, should be significantly different from the standards of practice of large enterprises. But we know that small enterprises and large multinationals are often intimately linked, or inextricably linked, let me say, along quite extended supply chains. So how does that relationship work? And I think what the Business and Human Rights Working Group is doing is saying that there is an enormous potential for the big companies, for the multinationals who source with the small and medium-sized enterprises to act as mentors, as vectors of good practice. And I really think this is the way to move forward. I don't think it's probably the best way forward simply to point the finger in a sort of in a more than necessarily accusing way at small and medium-sized enterprises. If they're in a supply chain, if larger companies are buying from them, it seems to me that the larger companies can play a very helpful mentoring act, but at the same time require that SMEs begin to raise their game and to meet the types of expectations that consumer in the consumer country would have of them. So yes, there are real issues here, but I think there are real potential and real vectors for progress that we need to exploit. And this notion of mentoring and partnership strikes me as being very, very important. The moral priority, if I caught the phrase correctly, I think focuses something on our minds on something which is very, very important. And in the most recent ILO instrument, the Protocol to the Forced Labor Convention, we reflect this. We really have to look not only at prevention, but we have to look at the victims. We have to look at access to justice for victims, and then the rehabilitate. What happens to the victim? And I think there are two things here. One is, all too often, unfortunately, the treatment of a victim can be unhelpfully linked with the migration status of that victim. I think you know that if you're dealing with somebody who is not documented in a certain country, the way that victim is dealt with can be highly problematic in several respects. And I think we have to untangle and work out how migration disciplines stand next to rehabilitation and protection of victims. I think that's one thing to say. And the other thing to say is, and to answer the questioner, I do believe that freeing a worker from a situation of coercion and often very extreme exploitation, with all of the human damage that implies, that's got to be done. But I do think finding a place for that person in the world of work, in labor markets, which meets the basic standards of decency, all the things that we all stand for, I do believe this matters a great deal. I do believe it matters a great deal, because in the end, the prospects for that person to remain free of abuse or free of the sometimes appalling consequences of the treatment that they have received depends, I think, very heavily on their ability to make a living in decent conditions and make a life for themselves and their families. So I'm pleased that the treatment of victims is attracting a lot more attention than perhaps it used to do in previous decades.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Kayla, can we have the next question?
We'll take the next question from Chloe Breyer.
Greetings. Thank you so much. I am involved in interfaith work, and it's come to our attention here in the New York area that at least one temple out in New Jersey, there was a federal lawsuit filed against them for having 150 workers who came to help build the temple from India and came in on R1 visas, which, as you know, is for religious workers. But that case is underway right now in the United States. I just wonder how many and what kind of consideration is being given to people who labor to create faith institutions around the world. And what's that seems like a somewhat unique situation. So I'm just wondering if you could comment.
Well, I'm not familiar with that situation. I have to say that it's not a situation which I've had to deal with either. But to just sort of extrapolate from it a little bit, I mean, we do know that private actors, but also states as well, are often active in moving on a contractual basis, large numbers of workers to work in another country. I think of the export of labor by North Korea in the past, to work in conditions of coercion and exploitation in other countries. And it's a matter of state sanctioned policy. And yeah, I think that these are really very, very awful situations, but I think they lend themselves to the same types of responses, the same type of action that we've replied that we've mentioned in respect to other forms of forced labor. But the example you give is yet one more example of the diverse, the stunningly diverse sort of variety of situations that we have to deal with under this generic heading of forced labor and modern slavery and trafficking.
Can I just follow up on that? We haven't talked a lot about accountability. And, you know, at the end of the day, whether it's a temple or whether it's just any random construction company, it will be more profitable, it will be less expensive if it brings people in and exploits them. And, you know, this is a common problem in agriculture and in construction and all kinds of sectors. Likewise, if you're a fishing boat captain, then it is going to be more profitable for you if you cheat people and lock them up on your boat. So it seems to me that fundamentally to disrupt that business model, you know, we have to make it less profitable for them or more dangerous for them. So, you know, they actually send some people to jail, take their boats, sue the companies, create real consequences for those engaged in abuses. How much progress is there in that, both abroad in the countries where this happens and among, you know, major international companies that use, that were forced laborers in the supply chains?
Yeah, I mean, this goes to the heart of the motivations for this type of activity. I think I've already mentioned our estimate of $150 billion profits from illicit forced labor activities. So the question you put is of fundamental importance. I think all the evidence is that the level of prosecution holding people accountable is very, very low. I mean, it's difficult to be precise with the figures, but the levels of successful prosecutions set beside all of the evidence we have of the extent of the abuses means that we're nowhere near where we need to be on these things. And here's a bit of a problem around this. Whose responsibility is it? In what area of policy is it a responsibility to make people accountable? And there's a bit of a joined up government issue here, it seems to me, because what's government services should be involved in this type of situation? Is this purely a criminal law enforcement operation dealing with organized crime and traffickers? Is it a labor market problem and a labor inspection problem? Is it a migration issue? Do we have to look to migration services? Is it, as the council report very compellingly argues, a matter of national security? I guess the answer is it's all of those things, isn't it? It's all of those things. And that, I think, argues in favor of a much better approach to bringing together in a more coherent way the efforts of different government services to make people accountable. It seems to me if you leave it to one part of the system, you won't get to where you go, where you want to be. And that same problem exists at the international level. So, you know, here is the ILO, the International US Department of Labor, if you like, with worker and employer attachments. We have in Vienna, we have the UN organization that deals with drugs and organized crime. We have a migration organization. And frankly, the danger of silo dwelling, not being able to join things up. And by the way, I would add UNICEF when it comes to kids and refugees and human rights. We're quite dispersed. And it seems to me that we do need, in the same way that we need national programs around the elimination of trafficking and forced labor, we need at the international level to conjugate our efforts. This is a mea culpa, Nick. It's not a finger-pointing operation. We're not as good as we should be at putting these pieces together.
One example of how accountability can make a difference, over the years, I periodically interviewed the owner of a particular brothel in Poipet, Cambodia. And I had kind of given up on the idea that there was any real remedy because it was so profitable for her to kidnap rural girls and lock them up in her brothel. And then really because of the trafficking reports and the pressure that put on Cambodia, the Cambodian police did not close the brothel, but they began to demand more in bribes to keep it open. And that meant that it was no longer so profitable for her. And she closed her brothel and turned it into a grocery store. And, you know, that it's an imperfect solution, but if it disrupts business models like that, then that's, you know, that's a step forward.
Yeah, Nick, just to add to the point you are making, of that 150 billion that I keep citing to you, two-thirds of that comes from sexual exploitation. The numbers of people involved are smaller, but the margins are that much greater. I mean, it's just extraordinary. So nearly 100 billion of that 150 billion comes from sexual exploitation. And the margins, this is interesting as well, the margins of profit are much higher in the developed world than they are in the developing world. So, you know, the business case for the exploitation of forced labor and modern slavery is actually stronger in the richer countries than it is in others. So these are elements we need to think about too.
Kayla, can we have the next question?
We'll take the next question from Aza Karem.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr. Ryder and Mr. Kristof. Mr. Ryder, you spoke eloquently and cogently about the various issues at stake. And Kristof, you always do that. Nicholas, you always do that on so many of these issues. One of the things that struck me from what Mr. Ryder was saying is how these issues go beyond one sector or one set of actors. And I'm curious, given that there are so many implications, economic, political, financial, the whole tamasha, there is also, I would assume, the moral set of implications that are involved in this space. And I wonder to what extent, especially this massive margin of profit that's made based on sexual exploitation, and given that really, sexual dynamics tend to be in the heart of all, to what extent ILO has thought to most institutional and moral capital in its endeavors so far. So governments, fantastic. The private sector, superb. Secular civil society organizations, fine and well. But where is ILO's particular deliberate emphasis on the mobilization of global multi-religious voices? Because I know that ILO has a legacy of having actually being the first entity to create an office for an advisor on religious issues to your Director General, but at the same time, it's very much cash population, so it doesn't even come to a quarter. So I'm curious, where are your efforts today to mobilize multi-religiously globally with this incredible sector that Kristof also writes tremendously well about in many, many iterations? Where is the ILO today in that space? Yeah.
Well, it's a great question in the sense that in the end, this is about moral choices. I mean, I'm sorry to bring it down, but the question gives me the opportunity. You know, the question is, at least when people are acting knowingly and in full knowledge, and we've talked about the problems of consumer information already, the fact of the matter is what we have to act upon is the readiness of people to benefit from the exploitation, the inhuman exploitation of individuals, be it sexual exploitation or economic exploitation. And you know, we have to remember that. Now, what about the ILO's sort of place in terms of the mobilization of faith-based moral pressures in this regard? Well, the question is absolutely right. This has been a part of our history, and you know, if you look at the origins of the ILO, I don't want to give a history lesson here, but when it was the Catholic Church in particular, began its social doctrines, you go back to Rerum Novarum back in the 1890s, a lot of the ILO was built on this notion of a values-based approach to the value of labor. And that's been a permanent part of our work and our character for all of the years. And I'm glad to answer the question that's put by saying, this is still with us. It was only a week ago that Pope Francis delivered a rather stirring speech to our conference in Geneva, where he reminded us in particular of our responsibilities. And he gave a message to governments, he gave a message to business, and he gave a message to trade unions about their respective responsibilities. And his focus, as my experience it has always been, is on the most disadvantaged, and most particularly, he insists on the dignity of migrant workers. This is very big with him, but also the exploitation of children and the indignities and inhumanity of forced labor. So, you know, I always believe, I hope it's not very old fashioned, that it is moral indignation that will get us past the post here. There's something very, very powerful about righteous moral indignation. Maybe it's gone a bit out of fashion in some of political discourse and some of the political space right now, but I'm a big believer in it. And the ILO has always tried to harness and must continue to try to harness, as journalists do, as civil society does, as everybody, I'm sure, connected in this conversation do. We have to bring that power of indignation, just simply saying, this is not acceptable, this we will not tolerate. And none of us have a monopoly on that, because, you know, if you go to India, if you go to the countries where, you know, a lot of the problems seem to have their origins in the developing world, that same feeling of indignation is there. It's no different. It's just making it come to bear so that people are able to live as they would wish.
Yeah, that righteous indignation is how we establish global norms. Gayla, can we have the next question?
We'll take the next question from Catherine Hagen.
Thank you very much. Wonderful to hear your remarks about this issue. And Mr. Kristof, thanks for moderating so well. I was very much involved as a former ILO official myself, as you know, Guy. Very concerned about the opportunities with that protocol that was adopted in 2014. For the social partners to play a far more active role. And I can appreciate your point that implementing it on a voluntary basis is a very difficult thing, and therefore one should be looking more at a regulatory approach to this. And I liked what you were saying about the international arena on this. And I was just wondering if there's something that could be done even further than what you've mentioned in terms of moving beyond the silos into a broader international approach. Just suggest an example, what about the WTO as a way to create a sort of a new thinking about the link between trade and labor standards, which of course has been an ongoing issue that has in fact flourished through the efforts that you've had on a number of issues. So it would be interesting if you'd comment a bit about that as an aspect of the way one could do something internationally to create a real consensus.
Yeah, well, Catherine, great to hear from you again, and thanks for everything you've done in this space. And of course, you've asked one of the key questions. When I was reading through the council report earlier on today to get ready for this conversation, I noted the recommendation in respect of the World Trade Organization. It was one page I underlined or highlighted in a bright color for future reference. The fact of the matter is that within the international system, and I just want to recall everything I said about greater coherence and getting out of the silos more broadly, but clearly there is a massive pressure point which resides in the World Trade Organization. Now, a long time ago, when the WTO was set up, there was a seminal debate about the link that should or should not be established between trade and labor standards. It was the famous Singapore conference of the WTO. And at that point, a decision was taken, and it was mostly the developing and emerging countries who were behind it, to say the ILO should look after labor standards, the WTO should look after trade, and never the twain shall meet. And there's been a sort of a fatwa out there ever since. It's as if, as I say, for those of you who know Geneva, as if a barricade had been erected down the middle of the Rue de Lausanne and we really shouldn't talk to each other. Now, that's not a sensible way to look at issues of international policy coherence, be it in respect of forced labor, be it in respect of the environment or anything else. And it's interesting today to see certainly the Biden administration's views in these matters. You know, whilst the WTO is making this artificial separation as a discipline of its trade processes, 2/3 of the trade agreements negotiated in the world today at the regional, bilateral, plurilateral level, contain labor chapters. They contain labor chapters, and most of those labor chapters refer to the fundamental rights conventions of the International Labor Organization, including those relating to forced labor and child labor. So there's a little bit of a disconnect here between what's happening at the WTO and what is going on in the world. So I think this is a debate which is waiting to be had. I was struck by the fact that the new Director General of the World Trade Organization, her very first speech on taking office, said, if you look at the constitution of the WTO, it's about people, it's about decent work. And I think if you take that simple truth and put it into context, then we need to renew, without revisiting the polemics of the past, we need to renew a dialogue about how trade can better serve, obviously to improve living standards and well-being in an equitable way around the world, but also how it can serve to help us eliminate practices that everybody considers absolutely unacceptable. So Catherine, you're pointing at a really, really important debate, and one that I hope will happen, not in the distant future, but in the near future. And I think there are some political dynamics out there which lead me to believe that is not a vain hope.
Bravo to both of you on that point. Kayla, can we have another question? And given the time pressures, it may be the last.
We'll take the last question from Teresa Lynam.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes.
Yep.
Thank you so much for this. So I live between Miami, Florida, and London, England, two global capitals with huge immigrant populations and many visitors. And I suspect that a significant part of these economies is built on human trafficking. So it's very difficult to root out and multi-layered. And there, it's so deeply rooted that it's involved, as I believe Chloe said, with construction projects and in caregiving and things that are really material to what people need. And a really weird thing is that religious organizations, and you're speaking to, you know, a religion and foreign policy group here, is that religious organizations are some of the least regulated organizations in the world, so can easily be created specifically as shells for organized crime and human trafficking. And we've spoken a lot about what political institutions can do, but what can regular people do about this? What kind of human, like regular activist things can we do to stop human trafficking? Thank you so much for taking my question. I appreciate it.
Yeah, again, a really important question. And I think I could refer back to some of the things I said. I think there is this righteous indignation that we all feel. And the fact that this matters to people and they will not tolerate it is a starting point, I think, in making the individual a key player in this fight. But then you've got to transmit that individual anger or that individual outrage into processes that can make a difference. And there, you know, if you believe in participatory democracy, and I still do, then you've got to make these messages known to your political leaders. You've got to operate through democratic processes. You can operate through civil society organizations. And by the way, I think religious organizations are massively on the right side of this argument. You've got to go through organized labor to take their responsibilities. And frankly, in the investment space, I think companies need to hear the voice of shareholders and investors about what their expectations of corporate behavior are. And yes, I mean, I think all important changes do come from the bottom up. It becomes evident that certain abuses are no longer to be tolerated in society. And that really is the way that we're able to move things forward. The good news in all of this, and we've lingered and understandably and properly so, on all of the bad news, all of the problems out there, is I think there is an upsurge. I think there is an upsurge in this moral indignation that will serve us well. It's it's the propellant of what we need to get done.
Our time has flown by, but Please join me in thanking Guy Ryder for his time with us today and for his work on this larger issue. And again, also just thanks to the council for taking on this issue, not exactly a traditional foreign policy issue, but one that very much belongs on the agenda. And I think the council report and this symposium help illuminate that issue for the membership and for the country as a whole.